Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So I am preaching on the gospel reading, but I'm going to draw the other two in towards the end. And I want to actually give you the title of today's sermon, because I normally don't do that. But I think it'll help us as we go through understanding the structure or the contrast between what is common and uncommon. So man is defiled, that is, man is common, until God sanctifies, or that is, God makes holy or sets apart. So today's reading is a continuation from last week's reading, and you'll recall that last week Jesus was talking about those traditions of men, such as washing hands, that become so important that they supplant God's word, that somehow they become more important to people, even viewed as the necessary things for salvation. And how Jesus says, no, that's not right, right? God's word is supreme. And then we lead into today, and we move from those things that are imposed from the outside that are wrong. And Jesus now talks about what's on the inside as he gets to the heart of the matter. If we were to watch the TV news, which I never advocate, right? But if we were to watch the news, we would notice that depending on which station we were watching, there's a slant. So if we're going to watch news that's produced from a right-leaning network, they're going to blame all the ills of the world, everything that's wrong, on the left. And if we're going to watch a left-leaning network, guess what? Everything that's ever happened in the world has got to be the right's fault, right? Anything that went bad. It's really how the world has been all of our lives, has it not? We look to that individual, that entity, that organization, and we blame them. Whenever there are two sides on an issue, one side always blames the other side for the ills, and that other side always blames the first side for the ills. We all have this same tendency. We blame everybody for why our lives are miserable. You know, it's his fault over there that the tree fell on my car because he didn't do his job trimming it correctly. It's her fault that my dinner was burned because she neglected it or she didn't do it right or whatever the case may be. It's a prevalent thought in society, right? Why is anybody suffering? It's because somebody is oppressing them. It's the government's fault, right? They take too much of my paycheck. They don't fix the roads. They don't do it. They're so far, or they're too impersonal. They don't really care. It's their fault. But society's not corrupt. It is not bankrupt. Let's say because of OnlyFans, if you are paying attention to the news, or any of those other applications or things that you can find on the internet. Society is corrupt because every one of your hearts desires what those applications and what those websites offers. Society is corrupt because of the condition of your heart. When it comes to sin, when it comes to the corruption of this creation, we're always quick to lay the blame on somebody else. We blame Adam for our ills. Now, in part, yes. He is the first of sinners, and because he did sin, yes, every one of us is a sinner. But it is not Adam's heart that lies within your chest. The blame game is only and always about hiding and running from the truth. It's always an attempt to put the blame someplace else so that we don't have to own it. It's about not recognizing that even we are rotten people. That we cannot help but sin. That we too doubt God's word. And then, like Paul puts it somewhere in the scriptures, right? That like the dog, we simply return to the mess that we made on the floor. Jesus tells us plainly, it is because of the brokenness that comes from within, the evil desires and the defiling thoughts that come from our own hearts. This is why the world is as it is. It's not his fault, it's not her fault, it is not the government's fault. We are in this mess because our hearts are polluted. All of our hearts. Every one of our hearts. Our condition is common to all mankind. Which is why us trying to fix it, whether it's by enacting purity laws or by adopting critical theory or any other kind of theory, by producing a cancel culture that tries to eradicate those that do wrong, or even by changing the way we look from our haircut to gendered reassignment surgery. They're all simply, if I can put it in this way, trying to clean the baby's bottom with the dirty diaper. Sure, we do make laws. They're necessary. We do have traditions. They are good. We force behavior. We coerce people to do what is right. We teach people. We hand down what is necessary for people to understand how things can be good and how they should be good. But those efforts do not, they cannot purify the heart. They don't even set us on the right track towards what is real holiness. They cannot change our status and make us uncommon. No, we need something, or rather someone, to come in and to cleanse that heart of ours, to scrub it clean of all of its filth, to fill it up with good thoughts and good intentions and good desires. This is why we need a Savior, why we need somebody to rescue us, to pick us up off of that trash heap and to clean us up, to polish us, and then to put us into good and holy service. Jesus takes what is common, he takes what is defiled, and he makes it uncommon. That is, he makes it holy. He takes what is undesirable and he fills it with his uncommon love. He cleans house, he sets up residence, and he puts in check those wicked tendencies, those vile thoughts, those evil deeds, and all of the unhealthy intentions that used to be there. He enters that abode of your heart and he fumigates it with his word and thus eradicates it of those pests. He cleans and he paints those walls with the vibrant colors of his own shed blood. And on those walls he hangs the lovely paintings of the history of God's interaction in this world, of his promises fulfilled. And he furnishes it with those comfortable couches of God's eternal love. He fills the pantry with sumptuous and healthful and wholesome food, that of his own body, given into death for eternal life. He takes you with your heart of defilement, and he makes you holy by forgiving your sins. He drowns that old Adam in the waters of holy baptism, and he creates in you a new person, one that is born from above, one of righteousness and holiness through faith. This, I would say, is the gist of what Jesus is saying in our text. Now, St. Mark, he puts a little parenthetical in there, and I do want to address it. Because, partly because we live in Maine, right? And if you know the Old Testament laws that tell you what you can and cannot eat, for the sake of those that fish for lobster, and for the sake of those that here enjoy lobster, right, we can give thanks that Jesus has declared all foods clean. That those things which we put into our mouth are not the things that defile us. But how much more can, how much more should we give thanks that he has declared us clean through the forgiveness of our sins, that he has cleansed us from all of our unrighteousness? Now maybe, I'm going to say most of you, maybe the younger ones don't know who Ebenezer Scrooge is yet. But that character, that main character in Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol, he becomes a fine example for us, I think. He starts out as this old, grumpy tightwad that cares little about the plight of others. And by the end of the story, he's transformed. He's transformed into a joyful and a generous man. Because of those visitations that he has that one night, Scrooge had a change of heart. In the words that Scrooge speaks, those words that Charles Dickens penned, he says that next morning, "I am not the man I was." It's a familiar tale. We see it in many kinds of stories that we read or watch, but it is not a story that is only fiction. For you, my dear friends, by God's grace in Christ's holy visitation and through the work of the Spirit's ongoing presence, you are not the people that you once were, for your hearts have been changed. Once you were captive to what lurked in your hearts and condemned, yes, on account of them. But now, by God's grace, you are saved. You are given holy things to think on, holy things to speak about, holy things for you to do. This is the very thing that God spoke of through the prophet Ezekiel, as Ezekiel writes, in the words of God, "I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean of all your uncleannesses, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove your old heart of stone from your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. You shall be my people, and I shall be your God." I want to back up a little bit, because in the context of today and our readings, the focus upon the Word of God and his grace bestowed as through that word, right, as a means of grace. This is what our Old Testament speaks about. It's what Ezekiel speaks about here too. As God says, "I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules." We read that oftentimes and we think it's a law, like it's a demand on us. But that's God's grace, where he works in us a desire to do his will, where he conforms us, as the New Testament tells us, in the likeness of his Son, to abide in his word, thus is to shape us. So as Moses writes in Deuteronomy, he talks about the people of God living according to God's word, abiding in his word. And what happens? They become a witness before the world, not because they're on a soapbox proclaiming anything, but because they are living out God's will. They have become God's people. And in that manner, they become a witness to the world because God himself transforms them. Paul writes much the same way in our reading in Ephesians. As he talks about the armor of God, everybody kind of gets a smile and they think, yes, I'm going to be this great warrior by arming up. But if we read those, as Paul puts them forward, they're all defensive. They're all gifts given to by God. As we abide in his word, we receive these things, and thus it's God himself who continues to protect us. It is grace, pure grace, totally a gift, because there was nothing in us that God should desire us, and there was nothing in us that would cause us to strive after or move towards God. But he has saved us by grace, that is grace in his Son. I'm going to use the last two stanzas of our hymn of the day as a closing prayer. We pray. By grace to timid hearts that tremble in tribulation's furnace tried, by grace in spite of fear and trouble, the Father's heart is open wide. Where could I help and strength secure if grace were not my anchor sure? By grace, on this I'll rest when dying, in Jesus' promise I'll rejoice. For though I know my heart's condition, I also know my Savior's voice. My heart is glad, all grief has flown, since I am saved by grace alone. Thank you.